Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Hello, my name is Dr. Himanshu Tyagi and I am teaching this course on heat and mass transfer. Let us continue with today's lecture. So, today we will be looking at lecture number 14, which is a continuation of lecture we have done in the previous session, and we will look at the part 2 of introduction to convection. Before we start, let us do a brief recap of the previous lecture, in which we started off with the simple question, because we are looking at convective heat transfer, that what exactly is convective heat transfer, and we try to identify it in the form of the fluid mechanics which is taking along with some delta T temperature difference. And this is because convective heat transfer is the form of heat transfer in which a solid surface loses heat to the fluid which is surrounding it, and it can lose heat in two forms. Over here we have given forced convection and the free or natural convection. So, essentially what it means is, if we have some sort of external force by which we are blowing the air, we could put a pump for liquid or a blower for air, or we can use our mechanical power in our body if we are blowing over, let us say, a hot cup of tea. So, all those examples are for forced convection. If something naturally cools without the presence of a blower, because of change in density with temperature, so a hot cup of tea will gradually cool because the air around it starts to move because of buoyancy effect. So, those kind of convective heat transfer are classified as natural or free convection. So, we looked at some of the very simple examples shown in this particular slide, and one of the main concepts that we will focus on from this lecture onward is figuring out what is the value of H. So, convection equation given over here is very straightforward, but the important thing that we have to figure out, which is little difficult, is what is the value of H, the convective heat transfer coefficient. So, we started off with this particular slide, then we looked at lot of images where we are able to see, for instance, over here the difference between laminar and turbulent flows. Ramchandraji, can we pause for a minute? Can we pause for a minute? So, in this slide we are seeing differences between the different type of flow regimes. So, two of the main flow regimes are given as the laminar and turbulent flows. So, in laminar flow, the flow essentially remains straight as given in the sketch on the right hand side over here, whereas in turbulent flows, which we encounter quite frequently in real life, the flow consists of lot of eddies, it is an unsteady flow, lot of perturbations are there, and the same thing we can see if we open up a tap of water, like it is given on the left hand side over here, low Reynolds number or low volumetric flow rate, the flow remains laminar, and at high Reynolds number, the flow suddenly becomes turbulent. And the same thing can be seen for various examples, like in the candle source given over here, as well as in nature. If you look at rivers, sometimes they behave as laminar, sometimes they behave as turbulent. And then we looked at the concept of, we looked at some images for jets. So, these are highly turbulent flows. Then we looked at the image for vortex shedding, and then this was one example that I was trying to give, that there could be different flow regimes in which the flow behaves very, very uniquely. So, over here we can see alternating vortices being shed from the top and the bottom side, and all this is caused by the presence of this cylinder over here. And I tried to explain that if we put a cloth over here, it is going to wave just like a flag does when it is posted on the flagpole, and high speed of wind is there. And this thing is important from the heat transfer point of view as well, because many times the fluid is actually flowing over several arrays of pipes. It could be in the straight array like it is given on the left hand side over here, or it could be staggered as is given over on the right hand side over here. So, these are all applications that we were very quickly looking at. And we looked at another image which was for dispersion. So, over here I do not think any mass heat transfer or momentum transfer is taking place, rather the species transfer is taking place. So somebody has taken this video in which they add yellow color edible dye to 2 glasses of water, and we can see the rate at which it actually mixes is much higher in A compared to B. So this is a very good example of dispersion, and I had explained yesterday that we can kind of guess that the temperature of water in glass A must be higher than that of in glass B, because the perturbations of molecules is much higher in A, which aids the mixing of this particular yellow dye. So with that, we also looked at the main problem that we will be addressing in this particular series of lectures related to convective heat transfer, and that is to how to figure out the value of H. In order to do that, we have to figure out what does H depend on. So it was not my intention to make it complicated, but you see inside this bracket there are so many terms, but later on we will simplify it much further. So there are some simple equations which will come out of it. Then we looked at some basics of fluid mechanics, because I wanted to start from the fundamentals. So we looked at the expression for shear stress, which consists of del u by del y. It is directly proportional to that, the velocity gradient, and we put a coefficient over here known as the dynamic viscosity, which is a proportionality coefficient. And we can also define a parameter called the kinematic viscosity, which is the ratio of dynamic viscosity to density. Then with the help of some examples, I try to show this very powerful relationship which takes place between momentum, heat and mass. So all these three quantities essentially in nature, they kind of behave the same, because they are the dispersion terms are added together. So the dispersion of momentum, dispersion of heat as well as dispersion of mass. So 2 slides back we saw a very good example of that yellow color dye being dispersed. And this is something we can see in normal room as well. If I light up some sort of agarbatti over here, then the smoke which comes out of it would gradually uniformly fill in the whole room, and that is a very good example of mass diffusion. So mass, momentum, heat, they kind of all dissipate or diffuse in the same way. Now continuing on with the basics for fluid mechanics, we went on and formally defined Reynolds number. So the idea behind it is at low Reynolds number as given over here, the flow remains laminar, and generally at very high Reynolds number, the flow tends to become turbulent. And this number which is given is for 2300 is the critical Reynolds number for pipe, where the transition from laminar to turbulent take place. And for a flow over a flat plate, that transition Reynolds number is much higher, it is about 5 lakhs. So these were some basics that we were looking at. And before we stopped the lecture, we had defined 2 non-dimensionalized parameters which are going to be very powerful. The first one is the Nusselt number given on the top, and the which is the ratio of kind of the strength of the convective heat transfer divided by the conduction heat transfer. So this bottom one would be for the fluid. So both of them are actually for the fluid. And the Prandtl number given on the bottom, it's also a 9-dimensionalized number, which is kind of a ratio of the molecular diffusivity of momentum to heat. So these are very strong and powerful relations, and maybe I can write on this slide itself that we were looking for the relationship of H for various types of convective heat transfer. Maybe I will go to the next slide over here. So we wanted to figure out that what is the value of H for various conditions. So in the next around 10 lectures or so, we will find out all sort of heat transfer taking place. There will be one common theme in all those 10 lectures, that the heated or the cooled surface will be a solid surface. So if you can see on this particular slide over here, we will have a solid surface at a particular temperature, and it's going to lose heat or maybe gain heat. In this case I am considering lose heat through convection, so through to some fluid which is flowing around it. So the fluid is going over here. We can have a vertical plate, we can also have a horizontal plate on which this flow is taking. It can even take place across a cylinder. So if there is a cylinder which is hot, then the air is blowing across it. We may even have a hot cylinder in which the fluid is actually passing through. It need not be just external to it, it can also be internal. So these will be all different kind of cases that we will look at. And in all these cases that I have shown over here, the flow is actually forced. So all these examples that I have shown in blue color, it's an example of forced convection. We will also look at natural convection, where let us say this hot metal plate, it is surrounded by air, but there is no blower. Over here we have a blower which is present, which is pushing the air. Here again we have a blower which is pushing the air, so as here, so as here. But even in natural convection, even if there is no blower, but the air, once it gets heated because of this temperature TS, naturally it will rise over here on both sides because of buoyancy effects, and even cooling will take place over here also. Q dot convection will take place over here. So, whether it is the blue case, which I will write as the forced convection case, which is what we will study first in the first part, and in the second part we are going to study the red case, which will be the natural convection, or sometimes it is also called the free convection. For both of them, or for any type of convective heat transfer, there is only one equation. So, I can write that equation: Q dot convection is H A surface area T, surface area A S, temperature of that surface is T S, and give me the amount of heat which is dissipated in terms of watts. So, in this equation, I will again write over here, everything is known except for this red H. So, this is the most important parameter, because this is not known. So, what I want to start today's lecture is with the final solution. And that final solution we will be able to achieve because of these two numbers over here. So, essentially what we will be able to do is, for every type of heat transfer, convective heat transfer, we will be able to write H in the form of Nusselt number. This is very easy to do, because if H is unknown, but the length is known and the thermal conductivity of the fluid is known. So, I can convert that unknownness to from H to Nusselt. So, instead of making H very important, I will say that Nusselt is the one which becomes very important, right? Because Nusselt and H are linked by just a multiplier. That multiplier is L divided by K, K of the fluid. So, that is something that we have to remember, this is the K of the fluid. Now, it so happens that all the correlations that are obtained, it so happens that for forced convection, natural convection, even if it is external case of forced convection or internal flow. So, in the external, the flow is actually flowing over the cylinder, and in internal case, the flow is flowing through the cylinder. So, in all these cases, we get very powerful equation, which looks something like this. That is the final solution. So, for the next 10 lectures, whatever that we will study, this is the answer that we are going to get. And this is for forced convection. What about natural convection? So, over here we will just replace this Reynolds by another parameter called the Grashof number. So, Reynolds, Prandtl and Nusselt I have already defined. So, I am not going to define them again, but I will write what this stands for. This is the Grashof number. Again, this is a non-dimensionalized parameter, and we will study this in the chapter for natural convection. But if we look at this particular equation over here, this is left hand side is Nusselt. For both these cases, what the expression that I have written is the value of Nusselt number. So, for all the next 10 lectures, whatever answer that we are going to get is going to look very similar to what we have written over here. And the only thing that we will get different in this case, to case 3, to case 4 and case 5, are the values of these three constants, which are C, M and N. So, those constant values will keep on changing. That for the diameter, it will be something else. For the cylinder diameter, maybe for flat plate, it might be correlation might be different. If the flow is laminar, then the M, N and C values will be slightly different. Once it becomes turbulent, then the values change. But the physical expression is going to remain almost similar to what we have written over here. So, as engineers, we can immediately realize that what we started off with was the holy grail, this variable that we are calling H, convective heat transfer, and that we have converted into Nusselt and finally into just three constants C, M and N. So this is something I usually like to do, give the final result first, and then I will show through the help of examples over the next few lectures and the next few slides that how did we end up with this simple solution over here. And one amazing thing that we will encounter, that these are the name of all these famous scientists and engineers, so Renault, Prandtl, Grashof, and then we will learn about Blasius and other people. So they have all contributed in the last 100, 200 years to reach that particular point that we and the students together can learn all these things in matters of few hours. So those people have spent decades and centuries figuring out these things. So let's go ahead and move in the same direction, try to figure out for ourselves what those engineers and scientists have shown to us. So the first, so we will begin very slowly. So the first concept that we will look at is the boundary layer. And there could be many type of boundary layer. So I will start off with the simplest type, which is the velocity boundary layer. So what is the boundary layer? If I can show over here on the right hand side, I will draw a typical aerofoil like this, or maybe I will draw a flat plate like this, or I will draw a cylinder over here. So boundary layer is actually a concept which people had come up long time back, that whatever flow is taking place over here, it could be a flat plate over here, and it could be flow over either a cylinder or it could even be a sphere, that the flow is taking place with some velocity over here, maybe u infinity, and later on we will add some temperatures as well. So throughout the velocity and temperatures are like this. So conceptually, if we consider some sort of a, in this particular case it is easy to say, a small region which is very close to the solid boundary. So if you are considering on flow on both sides, so this is the boundary layer that I am drawing for this case. Over here the boundary layer appears like this. So you can see that its thickness appears to increase with distance. So by thickness I mean this particular height. So this region over here is known as the boundary layer. So the name is self-explanatory for all these three cases. And the reason for this particular kind of a behavior is that the flow inside the boundary layer appears to take place, its mathematics, its physics is very much different from the flow which is outside the boundary layer. So I can put some dots over here, and this point I will call as point A. And over here maybe I will call this point as B. So point A in this example is inside the boundary layer and point B is outside. So over here I will put point A over here and point B there. So same thing is happening for aerofoil, and maybe the same thing is happening for a cylinder as well. And what we will learn in this particular slide onward is what exactly is that difference. So with that definition of boundary layer, or that just concept of boundary layer, let us go ahead and try and see on a magnified scale how would a boundary layer actually look like. So this is a flat plate I am drawing over here with black ink. So let me also put the x axis and the y axis. So x axis is like this, this is the y axis, and flow is coming over here. So we usually call it the free stream velocity. So this I will represent as u infinity. And I will explain in a little while why are we taking this symbol u. If you use the vector notation, so I can write velocity field as a vector with simply three components u, I, v, j and w, k. So over here we are considering a two dimensional flow. So it will have a u component and the v component. When the flow is coming from the left hand side, before it hits the plate, so at that point there is no v component. We can see this is just a horizontal velocity profile. Now what happens as soon as the flow reaches this particular point over here, then immediately after that it will hit the plate, and then this kind of a boundary layer will form which we have shown on the right hand side. So let me go ahead and draw a zoomed version of the boundary layer over here. So I can draw it something like this. Then after a long period of time, the boundary layer will itself become turbulent, and this is the transition point that I am drawing over here, and then over here the boundary layer becomes turbulent. So, if I have to show certain regimes, I will say this initial part is the laminar regime. So, here in the laminar part the boundary layer remains laminar. Then we have a very very narrow transition regime which is this narrow, and in reality I am putting everything, I am zooming in for everything. In reality this is extremely thin, maybe only a few microns. So, this I will write as transition zone, and after the transition zone whatever is there, all that is the turbulent. And if you remember, we have given some critical Reynolds number, Rx critical is approximately 5 × 10⁵. So, this value is actually taking place over here. So, at this point if my value of length is x, so then I can immediately write that this is rho u infinity x by mu is must be having this particular value. So, if rho u and mu are known, then I can calculate the value of x, this I can figure out. So, this is something that we will do in just a little while. Now, other things that I can mention is this is the height of the boundary layer. So, at this particular point over here, this particular distance I can represent as delta, and this delta is changing with x because over here the delta value is very small, and then as I increase x, delta value is increasing. So, I think this point is very clear what we are seeing over here. Now, let me draw the interesting part. Because I am talking about velocity boundary layer, let me go ahead and draw the velocity profile. So, if somebody asks what does a velocity profile look like, so let me first draw it for the free stream region. This is the velocity profile for the free stream region. So, I hope you can see on the extreme left side of the slide, we have drawn the velocity profile, and it kind of looks like a rectangle because all arrows are of equal length. So, I can even put a number over here, maybe I will say this is low velocity u equals to 1 m/s. And at all these points the value of u infinity is 1 at all these points, right? Because on this particular side there is no obstacle, there is no plate. If I can show this plate like this over here, if let us say this is the plate and air is coming in from the left hand side over here. So, till the point it actually hits this particular plane where from here onward x equals to 0, it starts from here and then it goes in this particular direction. Y is in the vertical direction in this particular example. So, when air is coming in from the left hand side, it is having the uniform velocity profile. I hope this particular point is clear. That is why we have shown it in this diagram. Now, let me try and draw the velocity profile at this particular point. So, I will choose a different color. The first thing I will do is draw a straight line over here. And then let me put some points over here. This is point A, B, C and D. So, since by definition they are outside the boundary layer, because this is the boundary layer region, all this over here that I have highlighted, all this is the boundary layer, and the part above the boundary layer is outside it, the boundary layer. So, their viscous effects are kind of negligible. So, inside the boundary layer viscous effects are very very significant, and outside the boundary layer viscous effects are negligible. So, if you go back two slides, we have discussed the value of viscosity and correlated it with the shear stress over here. So, what that kind of indicates is that over here the velocity profile remains the same, which means the velocity is exactly the arrows have the same length what they had over here. So, each of these arrows had a length of 1 m/s. So, over here also the length is 1 m/s, which means here at this particular point velocity is u infinity, and that point is true up till this particular green point which I have made slightly big, because this is just outside the boundary layer. So, this arrow will also be for 1 m/s. So, I can draw this rectangle as it is. So, I hope the students can figure out this rectangle on the right left hand side and this rectangle that I have drawn in green on the left right hand side over here, they are exactly identical. If you see any difference, it's because of my drawing skills. Now, what happens inside the boundary layer? So, let me make more points. So, this point that I have drawn, maybe this is point E, F, G and H, these purple dots. At each of these points, velocity is no longer uninfinity, it is much less than uninfinity. And that is because of the presence of viscosity, because of the presence of shearing effect. So, again, if I can show that particular diagram, the air which is present just above that particular solid surface over here feels a tendency that there is something which is trying to decelerate it. And that something is because of the effect of viscosity. So, if let us say lot of fluid is actually flowing over here, then immediately the molecule which is next to this particular solid surface, it feels an attraction to this particular solid surface, it kind of gets pulled back little bit. So, that thing I will try to show over here. And this first molecule over here, this big purple one, it will actually immediately stop and get stuck to that particular solid surface, and this phenomena is known as the no slip condition. So, if I can draw it like this, the velocity profile that I am showing over here is a gradually decreasing velocity profile, and the velocity of the last molecule, or I would say the first, the molecule of air which is closest to that of the solid surface, its velocity becomes 0. So, mathematically I can write that velocity small u at y equals to 0, which is this particular point. So, you can see the y axis over here. So, y equals to 0 means all these points at them. So, at all these points, all these purple points over here, the velocity is 0 meters per second. So, this concept is very important. So, I will just write it down that this is because of no slip condition. So, this is how nature behaves, that the fluid molecule which is closest to the solid surface, whether the surface is vertical, whether it is horizontal, whether there is gravity, whether there is not gravity, in general in the classical sense, the nature it is so explained to be behaving as that molecule has attained zero velocity. As long as it is a solid surface, there is nothing which can go through it, it is not a permeable surface, it is a solid surface. So, all the dots, all the air molecules which are closest to it, immediately closest to it, they attain a zero velocity because the plate itself is not moving. And the interesting point to that is if the plate starts moving, so those molecules will move with the same velocity as the plate, the first molecule. And all this explanation is summarized as the no slip condition, which means because of no slip condition, if I can put air over here, we see that the velocity at the y equals to 0 has to be 0, and then gradually the velocity increases as the length of these purple arrows over here indicate. And once we jump out of the boundary layer over here, maybe at these purple dots over here, velocity becomes the same free stream velocity which it was earlier. So, u infinity is equals to u infinity outside the boundary layer. I hope this particular point is clear. So, again, what is the definition of this particular point over here? What is the definition of the boundary layer? So, people have come to a consensus that this definition is given as the point at which the velocity becomes 99% of that of the free stream velocity, that particular point is referred to as the boundary layer. So, you can see the locus of all those points at all x positions, the point at which the velocity has become equal to 99% of that of u infinity, if we join them, then we get this particular blue line over here. So, I will redraw this particular blue line, and this is the boundary layer, because if you see it in two dimension, then it would be a surface. So, that is the layer that we are seeing over here. And now, with this particular explanation, if we have understood it correctly, after that, we can ask lot of questions. So, let us start with all those questions which come in our mind that okay, we have understood some part of what is going on over here, that initially the flow is laminar, then there is a transition, then it becomes turbulent, then we can see over here Reynolds number is directly proportional to x, which means if this is 1 meter over here and I know the Reynolds number is some value, that at 2 meter it will just be double of that because it's directly proportional to x. So lot of understanding we are having, but what are the questions that come in our mind? So if I can ask those questions on behalf of the students, the first question which comes in mind is that, sir, what is the thickness of this particular boundary layer? It kind of, we can see that it has to be a function of x. So it will be a function of, maybe I'll put over here, it will be a function of x and other parameters. So I won't put a bracket over here and I will say and others also. But what is its value? So I'll put a question mark over here. What is the shear stress at the wall? So the expression I know, expression for shear stress is mu del u by del y. And for wall, the definition is the wall is defined as y equals to 0. But I want to know what is its value, right? The third thing I want to know is if there is shear stress which is acting on this particular wall, then there is something which is pulling this wall forward, which means this black plate, not wall, I meant plate, this black plate, let me make it little bit thick, this black plate I am putting over here. If such a scenario were to happen in reality, if let us say this is my black plate over here, I will choose this one, color I think is better, and air is coming over here, and let us say it is a wind tunnel in which I am standing. So what I will feel is that because there will be some sort of a force which will be existing on this surface, my hand will have to apply equivalent force in this direction. I will have to push in this direction slightly, maybe with some number of force, I can say 5 Newton or 10 Newton depending on the area, velocity and viscosity and other things. Because the air, when it is going like this, it is trying to take this surface, this plate along with it, which means as an experimentalist, in order to make this plate stationary, even in the presence of high velocity air which is coming over here, I will have to make a balancing force in this direction. And this is not something new, this is something that we have all observed, that if I am riding a scooter, motorcycle or even in a, maybe these kind of things, if there is a breeze and I am carrying an umbrella, so all sort of forces act on a solid surface. So over here I will say that particular force per unit area, what is its value? So some idea I will get that these two are correlated, because I can say that force is kind of some approximate value, I can say it is proportional to the area. Then another question which comes to my mind is that will this tau wall, maybe it will be dependent on x also, which means it will increase or decrease with as we go along the direction of the plate. So these are some of the questions which come in my mind, but it is too soon to answer them. So we will just leave them as questions. We will go to 2 or 3 more slides. And that by the end of today's lecture or the tomorrow's next lecture, we will be able to answer all these questions. So that much I will promise. So just have little bit patience and let us go on and look at another phenomena. So I hope everybody has understood this first phenomena, that first type of boundary layer that we have talked about, the velocity boundary layer. So the other question will come that we are actually studying a course on convective heat transfer. So why is there no heat transfer taking place in this particular example? So in this example, I would like to remind the student that everything is at the same temperature. So the air which is coming from the left side, the flat plate, it is both at the same temperature. If the air is at 30 degree, plate also 30 degree. So even if fluid motion is there, so the convective heat transfer is 0, because it requires not only the fluid to be present plus some delta T has to be there. If everything is having the same temperature, it is just pure fluid mechanics. No convection is taking place. We go to the next slide. Here we will put some delta T. So here we will add, do the same example but with a heated plate. What do I mean by the same example? I have a free stream of air coming from the left hand side. I know its free stream velocity, but this time I know its temperature also. And the plate which is kept in the horizontal position over here, I know its temperature as well, and now I am assuming these two temperatures are different. In fact, I am assuming that TS, the surface temperature of the plate, is much greater than that of the T infinity. So just for some understanding, let me put some numbers over here. This plate I will assume hot, maybe at 80 degrees, and the air temperature I will assume is cold, 20 degrees. And u infinity I will also assume the same as in the previous example, 1 meter per second. Now let us see what develops in this particular case, and that whatever develops we will call as the thermal boundary layer. So I am just giving you information in advance. So we will have something called the thermal boundary layer. So what do we mean by thermal boundary layer? Let us see that in just a few minutes. I will put again the x axis over here. So this is x and this is y. So what is going to happen over here is when this cold air tries to pass over the flat plate, if I ask the student, what do you think will happen? If I may answer that the lower portion of that air, it will start to get heated. How? If I can draw in rough over here, if this is 80 degrees and then 20 degree air is coming over here, at this particular point heat is going to get transferred over there. At this point also more heat will be there, more heat and more heat and more heat, which means if I am talking about the bulk air temperature, I may expect it may become 21 degree, 23 degree, 25 degree and so on. I hope this point is clear. As the air moves forward, it should get hotter and hotter because it is gaining heat from the flat plate below it, right? But is it only true for those air molecules which are closest to the plate, or is it even true for the air molecules which are, let us say, 3 meter or 4 meter at a higher position? So over there, so these dots I will represent for these temperatures over here. These are air molecules which are very close to the plate, but what happens to the air molecule which is very far away? Maybe they will still remain at 20 degree. Maybe only after long time over here this becomes 21 degree. I hope you are getting what I am trying to show over here is two layers of air which is traveling over the plate. So the air layer, the layer of air which is closer to the plate will have a substantially higher, a faster temperature increase compared to the air which is at a higher location. And I think this is something which we can think from common sense. So based on this kind of analysis, let me go ahead and draw the thermal boundary layer now. And it will also appear similar to the velocity boundary layer. Initially it will remain laminar, then transition, then it becomes turbulent over there. So I can show these three zones. This one I will call as L, then very narrow transition, and then later on it becomes turbulent. But now I want to ask the question to students, let me pick a plane over here. So this is the plane I pick. At this particular plane, let me draw a straight line over here. And for all the air molecules which appear on this line, let us say A, B, C, D, E, and then new color F, G and H. So I want to ask students that what should be the air temperature for each of these points. So again, I will answer it myself that according to the definition of the thermal boundary layer, this is the thermal boundary layer, I will call it as a TBL. So this zone inside the thermal boundary layer is that zone which is actually experienced some temperature rise, and the zone which is outside the thermal boundary layer is that particular zone to which is flowing little bit higher, to which that information has not reached that some temperature, some heat is getting being transferred or the temperature has to increase, which means at all these points the temperature will be 20 degree, right? This is 20 degree, 20 degree, 20 degree, which I can represent by the length of this particular line. The only difference between the velocity and thermal boundary layer is I will not put the arrow, because students may recall that temperature does not have a direction. In the previous case, I could put the arrow for u as a function of y because I know the velocity has that direction, u is along the x direction. Temperature has no direction, so the length of these particular lines just represent the magnitude of temperature. Now what happens that the next green point, I am talking about this green point over here, if all these temperatures are 20 degree and the bottom temperature is 80 degree, my guess is this has to be higher than 20, maybe it is 25 degree, so I will draw it over here. Maybe below that it should be even higher, maybe 35 or 40 or 55 degree, right. And what happens to the last air molecule, which is actually because of no slip condition? You remember earlier, we have already seen that it will be stationary. It becomes so good friend with the solid surface. It has decided to stay over there, stick with the solid surface. It is not moving anymore. Furthermore, its temperature becomes equal to the solid surface temperature, which means the bottom point, it will become 80 degree over here. So then I can connect this particular curve like this. It goes like this, and then the arrows will be taken like this. So now what I have shown over here is the temperature profile inside this particular for the whole fluid at a particular location, maybe I will call it at x1, and I can do the same exercise for all different x's. And what are the unique things that I have to remember over here? The first thing is, outside the boundary layer temperature will not change, it will be equal to T infinity, whatever T infinity was. In our example, we have taken it as 20 degrees, so throughout it is 20 degrees. Second thing we have to remember, it has to be a smooth curve. And the last thing we have to remember is, because of the no slip condition, the bottommost layer of air, it attains the same temperature as the surface it is in contact with. And I think from physics point of view, it makes sense, because that surface below it, it is having some motion, vibrations, not motion but vibrations. Those solid molecules are at the same place, but they are vibrating, and the higher the temperature, it can vibrate even more. So the air molecule which is just present above it, it feels that vibration, and it gains the same temperature as the surface below it. So temperature becomes equal. So at this particular point, I can write, because of no slip condition, T at the surface, which is y equals to 0, is essentially 20 degrees. In this particular case, I will say it is T infinity. Whatever is the value of T infinity, I can change it around. So 20 in here is not an important number, T infinity is important. Okay. So I think this is straightforward till now. The one thing I forgot to mention is that over here also, we will denote this height as the height of the boundary layer. But this is not the same as the previous case, so I will put a subscript T over here. This also changes with x, and I will share over here that the thermal boundary layer, the velocity boundary layer height, I have denoted as delta x, and the thermal boundary layer height I have denoted with a subscript T, T for thermal. And they may or may not be equal, not necessary they are always that. It has to be equal. It can be equal also, and it cannot be equal also. So I will put equal and unequal both. So it depends on the fluid property. So we will come to that in just a minute. And over here, let me stop and slow down a little bit, because what I want to do is, I want to show at each of these points some convection is taking place over here. Similarly, some convection is taking place over here, and in between also convection heat transfer is taking place. So at any random x, if I want to write what is the rate of convection heat transfer, and maybe I will divide it by area. So instead of watts, what I am interested in is flux. So small q dot I will write. So this is small q dot. So if you remember, heat flux is the rate of heat transfer divided by area. And this, because of the definition of convection, I can always write as, this is simply h into Ts minus T infinity. And how can I write it? Because I know that here Ts is greater than in T infinity, so I will get a positive number. Y direction I know positive, so I get a positive number over there. But I have just told that the first layer of air is actually stationary. Then any stationary material, whether it is fluid, liquid, gas, solid, any other phase, then we can always say that over there, whatever heat transfer is taking place, I can correlate to its thermal conductivity. Can I do that? So the answer is yes, that has to be equal to the gradient at that particular point. So what gradient is this thing over here? Are we seeing del T by del Y anywhere in this particular curve on the top? So this is the gradient of temperature as a function of y. So if somebody asks me, I will say this is exactly this particular slope over here. The only thing is axes are changed over here. Here I am showing T in this particular direction, and then I am showing y over here. So it is kind of over here that t is in this direction. So usually we slope always take dy by dx, but here our y direction in this t is over here and y is over there. So I think we will have to imagine it slightly differently, and then we say this is at y equals to 0. Why am I writing y equals to 0? Because it is only the first layer of the fluid which is stationary. I can't write this conduction equation throughout, because there the fluid is actually moving. It is taking away heat and then moving as well. If you remember the first lectures, all lectures of our conduction heat transfer, we have always assumed the wall, the cylinder, the sphere, it is kind of stationary. Now what I can do is I can equate both of them. So if I put a equal to over here and I equate the top equation with the bottom equation over here, now I can say by equating these together that look, I can calculate the value of h, because I can take h on the left hand side, and what will I get on the right hand side? First thing I will get is all this thing, the conduction. So I will say this is equal to minus kf del t del y at y equals to 0, right, simply divided by ts minus t infinity. So our holy grail we have actually solved, or we have found. How? Because the kf value is known to us. This is the fluid thermal conductivity. Ts value is already known. I can measure it with the thermocouple. T infinity also I can measure with the thermocouple. It is just temperature of the air. Now, dear students, the problem actually comes is that it is almost very difficult to figure out this particular term over here. If it were easy to figure it out, to measure it or to verify it, then we would not have to go into so much trouble finding correlations for h. And that statement is true only for laminar case. In turbulent case, it becomes even more complicated. So ideally, we do have this particular expression, but it is not very useful for practical solving the problem. So this is useful just for the layer, because getting the gradient del t by del y is not very easy job. I hope it is clear till this particular point. Now let me do one more explanation, which I want to do, because here I have left some sort of a mystery over here. When I told that these thicknesses can sometime be equal and sometime it may not be equal. So for that explanation, if I can use this space over here, let me try and draw three different cases. So this one I will call as case 1, this is case 2 and case 3. And in all these three cases, this is the red line represents the flat plate. So what is happening over here is that when the fluid it appears over here, then immediately the velocity boundary layer is formed over here also, here also and here also. So with the blue color, I am representing the velocity boundary layer. And now let me represent with green color the thermal boundary layer. So I will draw case 2 first. So over here I will write this is the thermal boundary layer, and in case 3 it is like this, so this is the thermal boundary layer, and in case 1 the green. So in case 1 I have drawn in such a way that the thermal boundary layer and velocity boundary layer are exactly same. In case 2, the velocity boundary layer is this and the thermal boundary layer is thinner than that, and in the case 3, the velocity boundary layer is like this and the thermal boundary layer is greater than that. Which means over here, now we can clearly see the differences between delta and delta t. So in case 1, I can say that delta is equals to delta t. Of course, I am skipping writing the x just to save some space, but we all understand delta as well as delta t both are function of x, because they are increasing with distance. In the velocity boundary layer, what we are seeing is delta is greater than delta t, because the thermal boundary layer is much thinner than the velocity boundary layer. So that is the thickness. And in case 3 over here, our velocity boundary layer is much thinner than the thermal boundary layer. If you are feeling little confused, don't worry. In just 1 minute, we will get the solution. And the solution for that, actually, two slides back, if we go over here, is because of the gentleman named Prandtl. So, just by looking at Prandtl number, which we remember is the ratio of these two molecular diffusivity. One is the diffusivity of momentum, one is the diffusivity of heat. If Prandtl number is equal to 1, what does it say? That molecular diffusivity of momentum and heat become exactly equal. Now, we go back two slides and I write simply over here that for this case number 1, I am going to write that Prandtl is equals to 1. What does it mean physically? It means that when the air is coming from the left side and it hits a surface, this surface is actually retarding the momentum, it is slowing it down. If it is hot, it is giving the heat. So, the diffusivity of momentum, whether it is decrease or increase, or in the diffusivity of heat, whether it is in this direction or that direction, if they both become equal, which means our nu is equal to alpha, and that is the ratio Prandtl number, nu divided by alpha. If nu is equal to alpha, then Prandtl number is 1, that means both boundary layer have to be equal. That is why the green and the blue one are right on top of one another. Let us look at case 2. For what type of fluid do you think it will happen for case 2? Let us go back 3 slides. So, we will go back over here and we have list of so many fluids over here. So, let us take 2 extremes. One is the 3 extremes, liquid metal on the top over here, then water in middle and then glycerin at the bottom. So, we will remember liquid metal have low Prandtl number, water as middle, glycerin is the highest. So, what do you think is the fluid in case number 2? So, even if I do not know the name of the fluid, can I identify what is its characteristic? So, if I look at the curve number 2, the characteristic which I see is that the thermal boundary layer is lower and the velocity boundary layer is higher. How do I process it physically? What I can say is the plate is able to change the momentum faster then it is changing the transfer of heat. How do I say that? That is why velocity boundary layer is higher, thermal boundary layer is lower, is not it? If the thermal boundary layer was equal to it, then we will say both it is changing same. But thermal boundary layer, it is not able to impact much. Why? Something to do with thermal conductivity. Now, we recall those 3 particular fluids. First fluid was liquid metal, very low Prandtl number. Prandtl number low means very high thermal conductivity. Can that be the case too? I do not think so, because if that were the case too, then the thermal boundary layer would be huge, because the temperature would change very, very fast if the thermal conductivity highest, which means it is the lowest one, maybe the glycerin one. So, if you go back over here, we can immediately say over here that Prandtl number is greater than 1. Prandtl number greater than 1 means that the ratio of the diffusion of momentum to the heat is greater than 1, which means momentum is being diffused greater than the heat diffusion. That is why this VBL is having higher value than TBL. So, I have given it lot of thought, that is why I can figure it out quickly, because students are learning it for the first time. Do it slightly slowly, you analyze it, revise it one more time, but you will come to the same conclusion which I am stating over here. Now, look at the case 3, inverse is true over here. The fluid which came from the left, it got heated as well as got slowed down because of the stationary plate. But look how much impact is there of the thermal boundary layer. The thermal boundary layer is huge, which means even 2 meter, 3 meter down the line, the heat has traveled. The momentum decay is only maybe for 10 centimeter, 20 centimeter, it is much less. Isn't that how we are seeing this curve number 3? So, immediately we can say over here, Prandtl number is much less than 1 over here. Why? Because the fluid must be having very good thermal conductivity. If something is having good thermal conductivity, heat will travel faster than the change in momentum that will be taking place over there. So, I think that explanation explains lot of things over here. So, many very interesting things I tried to share with the student with the help of this particular slide. Let me also try and do, should I write one more equation over here? What I will not do, I will not write the equation, but I will just share one thing that it turns out that for laminar cases, for both delta and also delta T, we can see they are both varying, they are both function of x, and it turns out that they are both linked with the square root of x over here. So, as you can see in this particular, the shape that we are drawing over here, it kind of looks like the square root function. So, it is not a straight line, it is not parabola, it kind of the rate of increase is much slower as we go in increase in x, that is because it is increasing with square root of x over here. So, this is an interesting thing I just wanted to share, because in the next lecture we are going to see what is the exact value of delta x and what is the exact value of delta t x. There we will see that how it comes out to be square root of x. I think I have 1 or 2 minutes more. So, this thing I will just share one more point. So, the same analysis that we have done for flat plates. So, in flat plate we see this is the boundary layer, transition then it becomes turbulent, and it could be the velocity boundary layer, and it can also happen for the thermal boundary layer. For the same plate, maybe the thermal boundary layer larger over here. So, this is the thermal boundary layer, and it so happens the same thing takes place inside the pipe as well. So, if you have a pipe like this, and this is the center axis of the pipe, then immediately what will happen is that the boundary layer will form on both sides of the pipe over here, and eventually they will meet at one particular point. I do not know exactly what point it is, but we will figure it out very soon. It will go like this. And after that, the flow is termed as fully developed. What we are showing over here, I will put the axis over here, maybe over here. This is the x axis, because it is the cylindrical coordinate, this is the radial axis over here. I know the radius of the pipe. So, let us say the radius of the pipe is equals to r naught. Now, what is the importance of this fully developed region? I will just share in just a minute. So, this is the fully developed region from this onward, and this one is called the entrance region. And this length over here is called as LE, which is the entrance length. And one very interesting thing we will figure out later on is that in the fully developed region over here, if I draw the velocity profile for the pipe, it turns out to be a parabola for laminar case. So, if the flow is laminar, then this thing turns out to be a parabola. So, I can write this particular equation that u as a function of r is simply u max, which is this particular point, the maximum velocity 1 minus r square divided by r naught square. Whereas, if I ask students what will happen if I want to draw the velocity profile at this particular point. So, remember this is the boundary layer, this is the boundary layer, and these are the regions which are outside the boundary layer. Right, which I am showing in the shaded region over here. So, outside the boundary layer, velocity has to be constant throughout, right. So, from this point, I will leave it constant over here. So, I will put some arrows, it will appear like a rectangle, and then inside the boundary layer, it will be a smooth decay over here, and the same thing will happen over there. So, what we see is throughout the pipe, the mass flow rate remains the same, but in the entrance region the velocity profile changes many times, because initially it is a full rectangle, then a rectangle becomes smaller and smaller, then once it enters the fully developed region, then the whole thing becomes a very smooth parabola. So, these are interesting things, and we will study this particular aspect along with the heat transfer taking place inside a pipe, when the fluid or water or air is actually flowing through it. And this will be covered under the section called internal forced convection. These are very interesting topics. So, I hope you were able to follow what we have done today. We were able to look at the thermal boundary layer, velocity boundary layer in lot of detail. We looked at the concept of Nusselt number, Prandtl number, and I also shared one very powerful equation that I will show once again, because this gives up a lot of hope over here. And it makes life very, very simple for engineers, that all the correlations for value of H or the Nusselt number simply turn out to be as a function of these three or four coefficients over here. So, this is just a matter of figuring out what those coefficients are. So, with that, I thank all the students. Thank you very much, and we will meet next time for the continuation of this particular topic. Thank you.